In this song, Billy was making a comment on musical styles and trends. At the end of the disco era, the music press began touting new wave sound. Joel thought that this new wave sound was just a variation on the power pop that had been around since the 1960s. Around this time, Joel was often accused of, in the music press, as middle-of-the-road dreck. The lines, it doesn't matter what they say in the papers, because it's always been the same old scene, and there's a new band in town, but you can't get the sound from a story in a magazine, were specifically written to attack the press that was bringing him down. This was his first number one hit, spending 2 weeks at the top spot in July of 1980. This is It's Still Rock and Roll to Me. They started dating and moved into their manager's house, where Bono would write songs on the piano in his garage. He came up with I Got You, Babe, and wrote the lyrics on the side of a cardboard box. The song was their first single, and it spent 3 weeks at number one. And this is just a side note. In the 1993 film Groundhog Day, Bill Murray's character is awakened to this song every morning when his alarm clock goes off. The movie grew a cult of fans that now watches it every February 2nd, giving it a foothold in the popular culture. By association, I Got You Babe became part of the Groundhog Day tradition. This is I Got You Babe. The cover of his album, River of Dreams, was painted by supermodel Christy Brinkley, who is Joel's second wife. This is River of Dreams.
Thank you.
repetitive. It's the Beatles again. McCartney wrote this music when he was about 15 years old. And he used to play it when the Beatles were still known as the Quarrymen. He put lyrics to it later, and in honor of his father's 64th birthday. George Martin arranged this in the style of a 1920s big band, which came to be known as retro rock. McCartney's vocal was sped up a little bit to add to the effect. This was the first song that was recorded for the Sgt. Pepper's album. His bandmate, John Lennon, who is known as being of sharp tongue, said of it, "I would never even dream of writing a song like this when I'm 64.
Expect to see lips moving, because I know everybody on here knows this.
She explained, "Of course it was love at first hearing. There were cornfields and wheat fields in my backyard where I grew up on a Kentucky farm, and I heard a little bit of a gospel feel in that chorus. The minute Bert heard me singing it, he said, 'Stop, off to New York, we're off to New York.' That's where we recorded the song, 'What the World Needs Now.'"
the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now, love, sweet love, no, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain.
Every Breath You Take by the Police. Now, how does that fit into Killer Bees? Ah, we got you stumped. Well, who is the lead singer of the Police?
Sting!
There you go. Killer Bees, Sting. Don't be so sad. This is one of the most misunderstood and misinterpreted songs ever. It's about an obsessive stalker. And it sounds like a love song. Some people even used it as their wedding song. The Police frontman Sting wrote it after separating from his first wife. He explained it's a nasty little song, really rather evil. It's about jealousy and surveillance and ownership. On one level, it's a simple song, but underneath there's this distasteful character talking about watching every move. I enjoy that ambiguity. Like I said, it was the biggest song of 1983, excuse me. This is Every Breath You Take.
I'll be watching you.
That was supposed to have been our last song, but we we got some more. One of our favorite artists passed away recently, who was also a bee, Jimmy Buffett.
Yeah.
And so we thought we'd go back into our catalog and sing a medley of a couple of Jimmy Buffett songs. We're going to put together Come Monday in Margaritaville. It's two biggies. The downside to Jimmy Buffett's musical lifestyle is the time that he had to spend away from his family. He wrote this song for his future wife, who he was missing while on tour. When he sings the first line, headed out to San Francisco for a Labor Day weekend show, he's talking about a specific concert in 1973. One of his more popular songs, this is one of the big eight that he plays at almost all of his concerts. He wrote Margaritaville in Key West after he finished a tour with his group, the Coral Reefer Band. His producer, Norman Putnam, tells a story that one day in the studio, he comes in and starts telling me about a day he had in Key West. He was coming home from a bar and he lost one of his flip-flops and he stepped on a beer can top and he couldn't find the salt for his margarita. He says he's writing lyrics to it. Everybody says that that's a terrible idea for a song, but he comes back and a few days later and with his song Margaritaville and plays it, and right there, then and there, everybody knows that it's a big hit. Hell, it wasn't a movie, it was a song. So this is Come Monday and Margaritaville by Jimmy Buffett.
You back by my